Classic example, iconic product. We all have it at home. At least in US, there are more than one, more than two or three in every household, okay? We have to remember that before this, there was a successful brand called Sony Walkman. It was a $5 billion brand, okay? It has vanished. We don't talk about it. We don't hear about it now. What did this device do? They created, again, a platform so that we can individually personalize our experience. We can create our playlists, our news, our items, whatever you want to do, okay? That's co-creation of the personalized experience of N equal to 1. On the other side, if you see, does Apple own all the content? No, they actually partner with global content providers, amateur, and also professionals, and display by Toshiba and, you know, blah, 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 a lot of other companies, and finally assembled in China with a stamp that designed in California, okay? That's R equal to G. That fundamentally transformed the music industry. It's interesting. I actually, if I replace that iPod with iPhone, it becomes much more interesting because the argument is pushed further. I can personalize more in terms of what I can have, location-based services, what restaurant I want to go to. If it's vegetarian, I'm driving in upstate New York, I can find out that these are the places I can go to. Internet, radio, news on demand, personal shopping list, again, N equal to one. And you look on the other side, more partnerships. Again, orchestration of this experience through partnership network. But the question to ask is now transforming communications industry. Multi-billion dollar. This is the first time a regulated monopolistic industry. It is notorious where the power is now shifting away from the network providers to the device manufacturers. But we have to ask other questions, broader questions. So what does it all mean? Does N equal to 1 always should it mean that it is about me? It is individuality? You have to be very, very careful that all the models are moving in this direction, every industry. But the judgment call comes in terms of why are you creating this? In some cases, you can argue it is the savings from plastics and the CDs, and all the songs have been digitized. Billions of songs have been digitized. That means we don't use any of those, consume those plastics. At the same time, we can also ask, you know, how are we using the real-time contextual information? There are two different uses you can put to. That's why both organizations and individuals have to be cognizant of the fact, where is this taking us? This whole idea of N equal to one is all started back in, you know, Michigan, Ford Model T, mass scale manufacturing. From there, we moved on to customer segment understanding. From there, we moved on to mass customization. Now we are saying we can co-create an experience for every customer personally. Now, as long as that every personal customer, when your personalization leads you to saving waste and also make it more efficient and effective, it's perfectly fine. And you see this in insurance policies. You also now see it in shoe companies. And by the way, all this is now powered by digitization. Similarly, R equal to G, you can see we started with complete vertical integration, river rouge plant, produce to everything from rubber to, you know, iron ore, everything was converted into cars by one company, to a supply base and then global supply chains, to emergence of nodal firms and supply webs, where you have hundreds of partners coming together to create this. Does the risk increase? Obviously. Examples are Li and Fung, Apple, some of the examples. Prudential ICICI health insurance is a classic example where, you know, typically in a country like US, you never, health insurance, first of all, to start with, is difficult. And if you're a diabetic patient, no chance. This company, ICICI Prudential Joint Venture, came out with a very interesting experience where they said, we'll enable a platform and we'll create a policy only for diabetic patients. Because the fundamental argument why, as a diabetic patient, I'm not insured is because the dominant logic of thinking of companies is, well, because you're risky. I'm risky based on what? I'm risky based on historical actuarial data that I'm prone to more diseases. But this company, what they did, this joint venture, created a digital platform connecting towards this platform, the network of doctors, pharma companies, lab testing units, gymnasiums in the city, okay? And then offered policy to the customers, or the patients, saying that this will be behavior-oriented policy. We'll start with the same premium, but if you take care of yourself, and you exercise and you stay away from the donuts and the jangries or whatever it is, gulab jamuns, and whereas I don't, and I get tempted by those, then I pay the price for that, even though the two of us are diabetic patients. So it's more like behavior-oriented and compliance-based premium adjustment, not just based on actuarial data. You can ask the question, so R equal to G is not just about making partnership and extract the value from the suppliers. It should be about co-creation and sharing the value. So the question to ask is the objective here Are you trying to sell a policy to the patient? Or more, here actually they are also helping the patient take care of their health. More interestingly, these models are very interesting because when it is applied like this, if this insurance policy, for example, in health insurance or in auto insurance, also the same thing happening, what will happen if this policy start working? The good guys will start migrating to these policies because they take care of themselves and they drive very carefully, and the rest of them will be left with the lemons, right? Which obviously kind of will correct the market. The same thing is happening in auto industry. Traditional model about actuarial data, and then they give you three policies depending upon age, you know, gender, and how much do you drive and things like that. Norwich Union came out with this policy where they would put the black box in the back of your car and then track where you drive, how much you drive, how you drive. Then you can ask the question, well, traditional belief is that as a 17-year-old, 18-year-old, I'm going to be more risky. I may not be, okay? But if there is a 48-year-old there who goes to the bar every Friday and comes back at midnight, that person may be more riskier than me, now that we have the actual data, right? So the power of transparency can be used for the global benefit of all. But at the same time, it can also have the repercussion bad effects in terms of how we use it. This is more interesting to me. Zipcar is a company that actually came out, started by a mother of three. And she said, you know, we are wasting so much of resources, more consuming much more than we need. She came out with this model with her husband saying that, look, we can actually have a model for pooling of cars. You go to the website and then you select the car. The cars are parked randomly across all public parking lots. You go to the website, gives you a code, and you go and type that code, and the car unlocks, and you go and drive the car wherever you want to and park it the next place wherever you want to be driven to and leave it there in the other parking lot. So what does it mean? You don't own cars, okay? Shift from ownership to sharing. You also get an N=1 personalized experience because tomorrow it's a weekend, I want to take my two kids and the family in a vacation, in a picnic, I need a van. Today I'm going for a business meeting, then I just take a small car and go. Right? It is also more efficient use of the resources. It's a good example.